Hi everyone and welcome back. So you're in the market for a new bike. You're super excited until you head to the store and realize the multitude of geometries and suspension designs, and you ask the question, which one is best? There isn't really a best suspension, as everything is a compromise and it depends on what you enjoy riding, but today I'm going to try and help you out by taking a closer look at the 4-bar linkage suspension design of the 170mm 2019 Scott Ransom Enduro mountain bike. For this video I'm going to focus on what's going on at the back end. To begin with, we have the lower swing arm that's connected to the bike frame and acts like the chainstay. It is interrupted before the axle with a pivot to form the first bar in the 4-bar linkage suspension. We then have the axle as part of the seat stay that connects to the rocker link and forms the second part of the 4-bar. The rocker link, in turn, is connected to both the bike frame to complete the 4-bar linkage, as well as to the rear shock. The first things to look at is the wheel path during compression and chain growth, as these have an impact on square edge performance and pedal kickback. During the beginning part of the compression, the wheel path follows a mostly vertical path with a very slight rearward movement. Deeper in the travel, it then smoothly starts to arc forward slightly. The theory behind rearward movement is that when a square edge approaches, the wheel is able to move in the direction of the approaching object as well as moving upwards to decrease the jarring stopping force and maintain bike momentum. However, this movement backwards also increases the chain growth significantly, so vertical path is a good compromise between square edge performance and pedal kickback. Now let's focus on the chain growth. For a size large, the Ransom's chainstay length, or distance between the bottom bracket and rear axle, is 438mm. As the suspension compresses, this number grows to roughly 465.5, an increase of 27.5mm, or roughly 6.3%. That is fairly significant when compared to shorter traveled bikes, which manufacturers try to keep chain growth to less than 20mm. However, I'd have to do a full analysis of other bikes in the long travel enduro category to have a fair comparison. So a quick summary so far. The good is that there's a mostly vertical wheel path, which is great for downhill performance over rough terrain. The bad is that this vertical path leads to a decent amount of pedal kickback, which can have an impact on suspension suppleness if the rider keeps the pedals horizontal, which can hinder the chain from growing and the suspension from freely compressing. It can also be very tiring having your pedals constantly pushing against you on a long downhill. In practice though, the wheel will typically rotate upon suspension compression to allow the chain to grow. The next thing I'm going to look at is anti-rise and anti-squat. Anti-rise refers to the suspension movement during braking, while anti-squat refers to suspension movement during acceleration. The math behind these two concepts is quite heavy, but thankfully suspension engineers have come up with a relatively straightforward way to quantify both. When you end up braking, there is a force applied against the rider to slow them down, which due to equal and opposite reaction forces, leads to a forward force being applied on the bike at the center of gravity of the rider, shown here by a black and white circle. This slowing force exerted on the rider is due to the forces being applied against the wheels created by contact with the ground. For the analysis, the pivot point of the whole system is located at the contact patch of the front wheel with the ground. Think of it like the beginnings of an endo. Now the easiest way to understand the anti-rise is to see the rider forces wanting to rotate the bike frame around the pivot point of the whole system, pulling the bike frame upward and extending the suspension. However, at the same time, the braking force at the rear wheel seeks to rotate the suspension around its instantaneous center, thereby compressing it. How much this force wants to compress the suspension is dependent on the anti-rise of the suspension design. For the analysis, one draws a vertical line from the front contact patch and a horizontal line from the center of gravity of the rider till they intersect. This intersection is the 100% anti-rise point, or the point at which the suspension doesn't move due to rear braking alone. One then draws a line from the rear wheel contact patch through the instantaneous center of the suspension until it reaches the vertical line. If this angled line intersects at above the 100% anti-rise point, then the suspension is likely to compress during rear braking. Below this point, the suspension is likely to extend during rear braking. Too much anti-rise, say 150%, will lead to a suspension that feels harsh as the suspension is compressed so much. At 54% anti-rise, which is the Ransom at 25% sag for instance, the braking will keep the suspension active by not compressing it and making travel available to the rider. That's all for anti-rise, now into anti-squat. When one looks at acceleration, there is a force acting backward on the bike due to the rider being accelerated that causes the frame to pivot around the front contact patch and thereby compress the suspension. However, there is also a force exerted by the chain on the suspension that can counteract this, depending on the level of anti-squat in the suspension design. For the analysis, one draws a line from the axle center to the instantaneous center of the suspension. blind can be thought of as acting like a single pivot bike rear swing arm for this particular point in the suspension travel for the Ransom. One then draws a line along the chain line for a particular gear combination. Finally, one draws a line from the rear wheel contact patch through the intersection of these previous two lines up until it meets the vertical line drawn from the front contact patch. If the intersection is above the 100% anti-squat point, say with high pivot bikes, then the suspension will want to be extended and overly counteract the rider weight transfer. At 100%, the pedal bob will theoretically be eliminated as rider weight and chain forces will counteract each other perfectly. At less than 100% anti-squat, the suspension will be compressed under acceleration. So, back to our summary. The good news is that the anti-rise is low, leading to a very active suspension during braking. The other good is that the anti-squat is just above 100%, leading to excellent pedal efficiency with theoretically very little pedal bob. The final things I'm going to look at is the leverage ratio, spring rate, wheel rate, and progressivity. All of these things can easily be summarized as describing suspension feel. The leverage ratio measures the ratio of wheel movement to shock movement, and is purely a function of the linkage measurements. Therefore, it is frame-specific and unable to be changed without pivot flip chips, which some manufacturers have built into their frames. For the Ransom, the leverage has a very linear slope downward, resulting in a fully progressive design, meaning it gets harder for the wheel to compress the shock the deeper the wheel is in its travel. If the leverage ratio is flat, as in single pivot bikes, then it would be a very linear response, and there would be no change in mechanical advantage of the wheel compressing the shock during its entire travel. A linear response can make for a very predictable suspension, but also relies on the shock alone to prevent bottom out at the end of the wheel travel. Speaking of shocks, its spring rate is another factor in the suspension feel. For a coil shock, the force is directly proportional to the shock travel. An air shock, as used by the Ransom, however, exhibits a non-linear force response depending on where in the stroke it is. The difference compared to a coil shock in the first part of its travel is due to the breakaway force in an air shock, that is significantly higher due to seal friction, and only partially mitigated by the negative air chamber. The difference in the later portion of the stroke is due to gas law. Since the air volume is constant, if the volume of the shock halves, the pressure doubles, resulting in a doubling of the force being applied by the shock. This results in a pronounced ramp as one gets deeper in the shock travel. If one reduces the volume of the air chamber with spacers, this becomes even more pronounced. To complete the analysis of overall suspension feel, one has to calculate a wheel rate, which takes into account both the leverage ratio caused by the bike frame design and the spring rate caused by the shock design. The wheel rate for the Ransom exhibits a very nice linear slope during the first portion of wheel travel, leading to a very predictable and supportive midstroke as the force is always increasing steadily during the wheel travel. Near the end of the wheel travel, the suspension design is nicely progressive, leading to a bottomless feel as it's harder to move the wheel the deeper it is in its travel. So, time to take a look at our summary one last time. As mentioned, the Ransom suspension has a linearly increasing force response during its midstroke, as well as a progressive response at the end of its stroke, both excellent attributes to a well-designed suspension. There's definitely good reason why the 4-bar linkage has been utilized by so many companies and bike designs over the years. If you're looking for a new enduro bike, the Ransom definitely has a lot of pros going for it. Hopefully this video has shed some light on suspension design, and given you a good idea what to look for when out shopping for your next bike. If there's a lot of interest in this video format through likes, comments, and subscribers, I'll likely create other videos for other bike designs as a comparison. Until next time, get out there and enjoy the ride!